All right. Wow. Okay. My name's Scott. I start out with an right now. There's no. Okay. So these are the games that I've worked on. I started at Lucas Learning, but I'm here to talk about these games mostly. Probably not Costume Quest as much, but I also have done like a lot of comics and gallery shows, and what else? Illustration, children's book illustration. That's kind of the spectrum of what I kind of do. So, but today we're going to talk about some of these guys. You guys. Okay. Psychonauts. I get all dramatic, dude. I feel like I should be really dramatic with all you guys. There's so many of you. You guys, Psychonauts. Raise your hand if you have, just so I could... Okay, cool. Yes. Okay, I won't go in that much detail about it then. It's basically a psychic kid who goes to a camp with all these like psychonauts, which are very, you know, an epic kind of secret agent group sort of thing, and they all have psychic powers like telekinesis, and they can lift things and throw things with their mind and stuff. And he uncovers a secret plot, and it's really exciting, you guys. So, the main character. I'll talk a little bit about what goes into it. Because today, I'm going to assume all you guys know how to draw a little bit. And you know all the basics about, like, yeah, you know, you know how shapes, certain shapes make certain, like, characters, like, feel a certain way or look a certain way or act a certain way. You know basic drawing and life drawing and stuff. That's cool. But today, I'm going to focus mostly on, like, getting pumped about it. And finding the meaning behind what you're doing. Maybe the backstory and the character. You know what I mean? Like everything that you put in there it could be a story. You don't just put a bunch of belt buckles on a dude and a bunch of like swords or something, which is fine too. But if you have a reason for that, like the dude is really into swords or something, or he's really into belts. But otherwise, don't do that as much. You know what I mean? You have a reason for it because everything you put in a character has a story. You know? So for the first game for D'Artagnan was the name of the main character in the beginning. And he started out being really inspired by, he escaped from like a traveling circus, like a group of gypsies in a caravan. So, like he's very acrobatic. That's so he can do all the acrobatics in the game and everything, you know. But he's really into the Psychonauts, so he had to be very, very stern about it. And so Tim Schafer is the, you guys don't know Tim. He's really into the backstory of all of his characters and writing that all out, and he has an idea for this guy. The new Legend of Shaolin kid right there is kind of who he wanted to be like. He wanted to be kind of tough like that and really, really serious about being a psychonaut. So this is what he looked like. After a million drawings, this is what he looked like at that point. And this was the first character that we designed for the game, so which is probably a bad idea. I'll tell you later why that's a bad idea. But this is what he looked like. So we put him in the game and we started animating him. And he had a real big head, as you can see, you know, and we put more of the characters in the game, and as the style started kind of becoming a thing together, like a cohesive style, he became more and more weird looking, you know, and then ultimately when we focus grouped it, again. So then we went back and kind of started thinking about like what would be like really what he's about, you know, like he's really serious about the Psychonauts, and the Psychonauts were always something that you like you get comic books for and you'd send away for their special goggles and the decoder ring and stuff. So he's like a real fan, but he's also serious. So maybe he would have some of those elements, but then he would also be wanting to be like one of the most popular Psychonauts, which is this guy, Sasha 9. So he would maybe start dressing like him, wanting to be like him a little bit, you know? So that's kind of why we started, maybe he had some of these elements in there, like some goggles and some things he sent away for that he thinks would help him out, jumping into a mind and stuff. And then, or maybe he starts dressing like Sasha a little bit, maybe a little bit more Bauhaus-y, gets a little nicer. And I thought I'd put a cast on him. It's like, oh yeah, asymmetry's cool. And then Tim's like, oh, why has he got a cast? We got to write a story for that, you know? Like... but you have to, why did he break his arm? And I was like, I wasn't even thinking about why. So we didn't do that. But ultimately, we came up, this was the design that we came up with. And that was like millions, like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of drawings for this guy. And one of the things that I have, one of the things about, for me, as far as like creative blocks and trying to get past certain things, like I blame a lot of stuff on maybe the tools I'm using. I'm very superstitious. So there's times that like I'll be drawing like with pencil on paper and it's not going anywhere. I can't come up with any good ideas. I'm like, ah, and I go to Tim, I'm like, this is pretty good. And he's all, meh, pretty good. I'm like, oh, and then I go back and I'm like, oh man, this pencil sucks probably. And so, then I go back and I grab all my markers and I'm like, and I start using markers and I'm like, oh, right on. And then I get a couple good designs with markers. Moments in the markers and I'm like, okay, I'm going to use paper bag and draw on paper bag for a while. So in the beginning, I was doing a, blaming that for a lot of stuff. So that's why ultimately, after I got this guy on paper bag, I was down with paper bag for a while. So, and you know, and you got to try out like drawing the characters in all the different positions and like not just drawing them in a pose, but then like trying them out, like doing some of the things that you want them to do and see how the character works and if it tells the story of who that person is. Like, this is she. And as you can see, I wasn't very organized with my character sheets there. And then other times, like, certain characters are inspired by actual people. Like, Sasha was inspired by Kyle MacLachlan, and Bobby Zilch was the bully in the game, and he was inspired by Farkas. So it was really angles, but it was inspired by, you know, you pull the vibes from these guys. You're not copying them. You're pulling the energy from these dudes. And so he's a lot of weird angles. That doesn't look like Farkas, really, but... anyways, and this is another one of the orderlies, and he was inspired by Steve Buscemi. And he put little notes on there and make sure they know that there's very greasy hair. Because you got to give the modelers a lot of so they, you know, maybe you can work together on shaping how the character is and stuff. So, and if the programmer needs to have greasy hair tech, then that's what needs to be done. Okay, so here's the next game we're going to talk about, Brutal Legend. I wonder how many, okay, you guys are great. I'm really excited that you're here. So basically, Brutal Legend was the story of a roadie that's pulled back in time to the age of metal, which is basically it doesn't look like how it does, which is of course the Middle Ages, right? But it's not how we think Middle Ages look. It's basically what all the album covers look like. That's what the Middle Ages look like chrome volcanoes. Grown out of the environments and stuff. It's just nuts because that's what's on these covers and stuff. So so the elements that we needed to pull from this, it was a very different style. So so we definitely were looking at like Frank Frazetta and just hot rod culture itself and just, you know, rock stars and all that jazz. Tough jazz, actually, not jazz, but so these are all the things that we were pulling from. And in the beginning of a project, you know, you want to surround yourself with as much reference as you can, like in the world. I mean, I'm super addicted to the reference to the point where maybe it's a procrastination tool for me. So we have a room at Double Fine where it's in the back, and we just cover the walls with whatever we're getting pumped on. And so in the pre-production phase for this, we just covered the walls with, you know, Tim brought in his record collection. We brought, you know, we put in all these, like, images from, like, Nordic landscapes and Frank Frazetta and all these barbarian things and, like, just amazing hot rod stuff we found, like, and kind of just, like, thought of, like, what would be in the heavy metal game and just surrounded ourselves with it. Just surrounded every square inch. And then you just sit in it. and you take it in. You take in this amazing room you created and this amazing world that you kind of, and then you start kind of maybe making lists. Because I start with making lots of lists, and we are all making lots of lists of just stuff that you would see in a crazy world like this, you know? So, and then we had the basic rule of putting out, if you design something like, yeah, that's a cool alligator or whatever, but like what makes it specific to this world? What makes it unique to this world? And we had a blueprint of stuff because of this heavy metal and this amazing backstory that Tim wrote, this huge, huge lore that starts from the beginning of time when it's just a world covered in mud and writhing creatures. That's like an epic backstory. That's not just like my mom grew up here, you know? It's crazy. So we had like, so he had all the reasons why this world was how it was and why the world was growing exhaust pipes and why it had oil that you could, you know, well actually I guess we have oil we could mine. Don't we? Fossil fuel. Anyways, there's more badass versions of that in this world. So the test was always you put it on a heavy metal cover, and if it will be cool enough for Motorhead to put on their record cover or something, then it's cool. If it's not, if you don't think those guys are going to like it on the record, then it's not a good design. It's one of our rules, you guys. So in the beginning, we kind of just threw out a lot of drawings, and I didn't do this cartoony one here. This is Raz Mavlin, who's amazing. In the beginning, we were trying to go the extreme of figuring out what style we want to push, like these characters and everything. So we were just drawing tons of crazy stuff. And one of the lessons that we learned with Psychonauts was you don't start with the main dude. You start with a cast of dudes and a cast of ladies and kind of get your style there and get your world there and then see who would work as a charismatic lead, you know? So that's what we did here. We just came up with all these creatures and put them together in groups, and we're like, okay, this is going to be great. This is going to be how the world is going to be, you know? And then we're like, okay, now who's going to be a good leader in this group? And the roadie himself, that character, Tim was always basing it on this fellow right here, which his name is Lemmy. He was based on him because he's the most respected dude in metal. He's like a real legit dude because he started out as a roadie and then he became a rock star after that. So he's just very respected. People are like, dude, he knows everything about everything. And you're like, dude, well, I don't know if he knows everything about everything, but you trust him to take care of you, man, because he knows his stuff. Because look at him. It's cool, right? And he always wears the same outfits because he knows those are cool outfits. So in the beginning, we were kind of trying to have it be inspired, the main character inspired by Lemmy, you know? So, and we were trying to pushing the proportions and see how stylish we wanted it, how realistic we wanted it. So, and I did a lot of design work in meetings and stuff, so that's why there's a lot of binder paper ones. And we kind of were trying him out in the things that we'd need him to do, you know, the situations. Like, he would need to be a respected roadie on one hand, you know, telling dudes what to do. And then he'd need to command demon armies with his demon wings also. So he has to be able to do both those things, you guys. And he looks pretty badass, right? Doing this? These paintings are cool. Yeah, nice. Let's take him in for a sec, you guys. Okay. But as we were kind of trying to figure out how the game would work and how you'd tell this story, and you kind of like, you're thinking like, the main character that comes back to this world, it's like, you as a character, you as a player, want to play this person. You have to want to play this main character experiencing this new world. This is a new world that's amazing. This is a fantasy world for any metalhead, you know, any fan of metal. But we kept on thinking, the more we were kind of, we wanted there to be a little bit of emotion in this guy, the main character. And as much as we wanted it to be like Lemmy, he just looked like he's almost too cool to experience it like we would all experience it. Like if he saw like a volcano running down a monster back that's like, you know, has metal shards pouring out of his insides, like you'd be like, dope. Like we would be like, that's crazy. But it seems like he'd be like, oh yeah. Yeah, that's what's happening there. I know that's real. And it's like, and that's like no fun to play a guy like that. Really, you know, because you want to kind of get excited. That's kind of why Harry Potter is so rad. I'm a fan of Harry Potter. Because he goes into this magical world, and you as a reader, you're reading along with him. Everything he sees is crazy, and he's getting excited about everything. And you as a player want to feel that. So it's like, and not only that, but he's the most important dude in that world. That's like fantasy land, you know? And same with Luke Skywalker. You know that guy? So anyways, so that's kind of like what we wanted. So then we started looking more at Jack Black, just because he would get pumped on it. But he would kind of try to hold it in, but he'd also show that he knows his stuff. He's a connoisseur of metal, and he's actually badass at metal, at playing it and performing it. So we kind of went back towards that kind of vibe. So that's kind of where we went more towards that, and then kind of came with this dude. Threw a little Danzig in there with him. And it made him a little buffer than Jack Black. And that's cool. We tried him out with some other characters. And he worked out pretty good with some of these other guys hanging out. And then we put them, we did these paintings to show off like how the gameplay might work and what situations you might work in. And then he worked good. There he is, riding that dude. Let me see how. Look at my trusty thing here. Oh. Okay. What? Okay. Sorry, you guys. Back behind the scenes. So I think I need to kind of move on pretty quick. I'll go by this really quick. So some of the other characters in Brutal Legend that were like, what time? How much time do we got? 40 minutes. Fantastic. Okay, then we'll just skip this stuff. Hey, I'm doing some rambling, you guys. I didn't see my thing here. But anyways, this is another character, Ophelia. She was... anyways, we'll skip Ophelia. Here's some of the drawings of Ophelia, you guys. I mean, basically, we were kind of making her, trying to make her gothy, and she sacrifices herself in the Sea of Black Tears, and she rises up again as a phoenix. So she would need to fly and command armies too. So we were trying all these elements on her, and then we decided that the sea itself would kind of create her outfit, rather than create all these nice outfits. That was the special thing there. And then for the hair metal dude, he had to also fly, and it would make sense to have his hair because it's such a big part of his character. That's the big part of flying. Okay, so really quick, I'm going to go through this really quick because we got to get to drawing. So this is how I work. So I gather lots of reference. This, by the way, this is like one of the characters from our new game. Broken Age, you guys, where I would just collect like photos and just crafts and any paintings and anything that would make me feel a certain way and feel really good and relaxed to start drawing and coming up with ideas and stuff. Because I just want to relax myself as much as possible. So this is not from that game, but... this is what typically what like how I come up with ideas. I just make lots of lists and I just jot down stuff and I just kind of let things flow. However, you know, the list could be about anything, whatever, you know, as long as I'm able to relax myself. And I use Xerox paper in order to kind of relax myself because sketchbooks kind of stress the of it. It makes me relax a little bit more. So I do this sort of thing and just kind of let it go, and then gestures out of like how shapes might work, and I try to just pump a million of these out, so not one of them is really important. You know, like you're kind of just trying to get the ideas and the feelings out. So these are just kind of ideas for this main character. She's in this village. These are also could double as villagers at this point. Yeah. And then we start to close in on some of the characters, and then scanning them in and just putting some value in there and some letters so that people can kind of point out the ones that they like and what elements they like, and then we could start to mix and match and put them together in other ways. And then start putting them in situations, you know, like that they'd be in the game maybe and see how they'd work. And then just narrow them down to a few and do some color roughs, and this is when you kind of maybe I put a little bit more time into it, you know. And then we choose them. Then we choose one. And then we kind of push that a little bit more, you guys. And then I make a character sheet. As you see, it's a really rough character sheet, but you just get an idea, you guys. Just getting the gestures, because they're making it, right? Some head stuff. And this is how she turns out. This is what she is like in the game. All right. So, that's the talk portion. Now we're going to do some drawing together, you guys. And I have these three assignments for us. And by the way, we'll do questions at the end. I think I was supposed to say something else. Oh, yeah, turn off your cell phones. You're going to get an email evaluation after the panel. So just, you know, give me lots of good feedback. Cool. And for Q&A, we'll just come up to these mics, but we'll go to that later. Okay, let's go back to the assignment. Get out your drawing materials, everybody. I've never done this before, but I think it'll be fun, right? It will be so fun. So these are the three assignments. So the first one is draw a sad creature that lives under a rock or in a hole. The creature helps the player get past the raging river somehow. The creature has a weapon. Sometimes this is as much information as you get, guys, on a character. Number two, draw a scientist. A scientist that is discovering an amazing, earth-shattering thing, a very excitable person, longs for the world to experience the new thing. Oh, man, so excited. Okay, and the third one is draw a sneaky golem, an old, ugly dude that has no friends except for his collection of rocks. And I've taken upon myself to gather a little bit of reference for each one. This is my reference for the sad creature in their zone. This is the scientist's reference. And this is the golem reference, okay? So, who would like to do number one? This guy here, sad creature. Okay. Cool. Who would like to do the scientist? Oh, boy, this is going to be closer than I thought. And who wants to do the golem? I might need some help figuring this out. Lee, dude, help me figure this out, dude. I can't figure... Cheer?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good way to get pumped, right? Who wants to do this one, the sad creature? Sounds good. Who wants to do the scientist? So far, that's winning. Who wants to do the golem? Sounds like golem? Yeah, that's hard too. All right. Let's do the golem, you guys. All right. So here's my drawing materials. Oh, wait, let me switch. Oops. Move over here. Guide, move over here. Okay. Oh, this is my spot. So we're going back to this. Here's my some of my drawing utensils. I usually just use this one though, you guys. Right now, this is my feeling good one. This is my 6B pencil. Okay, let's get pumped. Let's put on some music for us to relax to. Not so quiet. Okay. All right, you guys. Who's excited about this drawing? Drawing. You guys are awesome. Playing my music. I love you guys. If you don't like this music, that's too bad. I'm gonna put it on. This is some Augustus Pablo, which is relaxed. Okay. So I have this weird thing. See, this is why I'm superstitious, you guys. I have this old sketchbook from when I used to work at Lucas, 15 years ago or so, and it's, for some reason I like to draw on top of it instead of the table. Okay, let's get started here. So we're doing the golem, right? Is that what we're doing? Okay, guys, I'm going to go back and forth. This is how we're doing it. This is what the reference looks like. And this is me drawing. Boy, am I procrastinating right now. Okay. So, there's this guy. By the way, you guys are welcome to just talk amongst yourselves, too. It's okay. That's what happens in the studio. This is the biggest studio of all time. So sneaky golem, he's an ugly dude, and there's no friends except for his rocks. I decided he's going to be a rock dude already. So, first thing I do is do some copying. So I can relax a little bit. Oh, is this the mic? Dude in the corner. Oh, you can't even see him. The dude in the corner seems like kind of a weird bearded golem. I don't know, he doesn't really strike me as a golem, but I'm gonna draw him anyways. So okay. Maybe there's some rocks he can dig. Some other stuff. Oh, he probably loves geodes. Those are cool, man. That's where you put your little pewter action figures in. This is a geode. Maybe he lives in it. It's pretty cute as this way. He's sad, but he wouldn't mind a visitor. Yeah, I know. Just because he's, like, got no friends and he's sneaky doesn't mean he's just a bad guy. Well, he's sneaky. Yeah, he can be sneaky and a good guy. Right, everybody? There he is in his geode. Probably likes crystals, too. But maybe not. He seems like more of a just stone dude. Light works. So it goes. It's just the idea phase. Sometimes, maybe in this world, light works different. We don't know. We don't know, you guys. He's a happy dude. It's made of rock. See? Stood out. No, I'm just kidding. I'll probably scan all this in and try to use some of it. I usually just scan the stuff in and if I like how a drawing looks or a dude looks, sometimes it's hard to reproduce it. I'll just scan it in and trace it. I'll blow it up. Ooh. That looks a little. Maybe that's him. This is rock. This guy likes crystals. It's shiny. And there's also this guy. You guys know the dude on the top right, right? From that movie Gollum? Der Gollum, I think it's called. It's that silent film. Cool. Let's check it out. What I always think of that dude, and he has this amazing shape head that I'm not going to rip off. Oh man, I'm glad you guys chose Gollum. This guy's cool. He's sneaky, though, so maybe he's... You guys drawn? Who's drawn? Yes! Dude. Who's excited about it? You guys cut off... You guys are good at cutting off exactly the right moment. By the way, I don't want to get you guys' hopes up. We're not going to see a finished amazing character today. We're just going to get some ideas out. Because usually I would probably just scan it in and try to make it amazing. But you know what? Why sell myself short? Maybe it's going to be amazing. Maybe it is going to be amazing. I'd love to see the ones you guys do later, also, if we can figure out how to do that. This is how you know he's made of stone. You gotta put the stone stuff. Cracks. Otherwise, he's just a gnome. Okay. Yeah, because he's sneaky guy. Music. Let that music relax you guys. This guy seems sneaky. Okay. I'll let you guys look at this for a bit. All right. Switch it back. I'm doing a list again. Just places he might hang out. So yeah, sorry guys, I get in my head here, make a list. So this is like a list of just, what I like to do sometimes is like make a list of just things that, just kind of riff on words that might remind me of the other word in a way, because then that could, it's like an improv thing. I do improv as well, you guys, which is a really good thing, tool, creative tool for people to write and illustrate. But if you like, kind of let yourself kind of stream of consciousness, like write down words and start with some that, and some of them might have something to do with what you're designing and some of them might not have anything to do with it, but you're just kind of flowing because you don't know what this list might bring you to, you know what I mean? Like it might bring you to an idea that might be cool or something, you know? Or to keep in mind these elements as you're drawing a dude, you know? That works for me at least, you guys. Might not work for you. I'm just going to write that word. It makes me feel good. Okay. Oops. I'm really stuck on giving him rocks to hold for some reason. What else? So this guy might have been a boy that was turned into a rock golem. Maybe he's cursed. So yeah, maybe he's... I don't think he's a sneaky guy. That's one spot to use here. Maybe he's skinny. So what's the deal with golems again? Wait, are golems like a cursed dude, or is it a dude like a Frankenstein? It's like a Frankenstein, right? Made out of clay. Dude, interesting. I should research that one. What? Yeah, man. That's good. So they're made out of clay, and they're like a Frankenstein dude. Okay. I was going more with made out of rock than cursed. Hey, that's cool. Teach his own in the world of golems. I like it. Do some chatting. Okay. As you can see, this is all just coming up with ideas, you guys. That's all. I should give them all the same feet. Maybe I should think about that. I know these guys are really sneaky though. Maybe he's wearing an algae shirt. Because I wrote that down on the list. Is it? Gives me much more than that. Okay, let's think. Maybe he's wearing a rock hat. Here's his collection. Rocks. He's worried. Alright, well, that's not an amazing design, you guys, but hey, it's an idea. I don't know what I mean. So this is considered just the first pass, you guys. First pass, if you get like an assignment like this, this is how you just kind of get in the zone. And then you scan all these in. See, I'm quantity not quality at this point. Because it doesn't matter. Just like, we're just trying to get some stuff out. Oh, here's what this guy looks like. And then you kind of do that pass, and you scan these in and kind of try to arrange them nicely, and maybe put a little bit of like shading in there so people can think I put some a lot more work into it, and then send it to them and just kind of bombard them with stuff, you know. And then there's a second pass, third pass, fourth pass, fifth pass, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, maybe 25,000 passes. Perhaps. That's how it works sometimes. And sometimes maybe just one pass, but almost never. I have only nailed a character once in my life, right away. Do you know who that is? It was because it was the first, only because Tim wrote a character based on this guy, that's the only reason. It was one of the first drawings I ever drew for when I started at Double Fine working on Psychonauts, the first character I ever. Only one that nailed in the first drawing was Dogen. I drew a character that looked like this character, Dogen. This guy with a cap on his head. And that was like one of the first drawings I drew. And he made it in the game exactly like that. only time in my life that a character is the first try. I think. This dude's probably blind, right? Yeah, I don't know. Maybe he has a tail of rocks. Looking good. Looking good, Scott. Come in. All right, we'll do a couple more sketches and then we'll do some questions and chatting together. I don't know what that is. Maybe he's a small call. Guys, I guess this gum, I'll just make this gum be him. Give him some algae. Anyways, you guys, I think we'll, oh, here's the full thing. I think we will conclude this part and then maybe have some questions. What do you think? That sound good? How good does it sound? Exciting one ever. Okay, so thanks you guys for hanging out. We'll do some questions now. If you guys can like cruise up to these two mics and we'll just go back and forth or whatever. It's probably the easiest, and then everyone can hear your question and stuff. So feel free to make your way up there whenever you want. At your leisure. And it could be a question about anything. About drawing, how you do it. Hi.
I'm Elise. Go through that, and I guess that also involves a little bit of creative block.
I'm sorry, say again? Maybe speak a little bit into the microphone.
Sorry. I'm talking to a lot of people. Hi.
Thanks for being the first one. You're the best.
Yeah. Okay,
oh, wait,
so
here's a consolation prize. You can have one of these for being the first person. You can have one of these.
Ah, thanks. So you briefly talked about creator's block.
Yeah.
And how you tried different materials, and one of them was the paper bag.
Yeah.
And I was also wondering if you could talk about further from that, like discouragement. Like you're really working hard and you just can't get further.
You know what? It's weird. I think, like, you know, let me turn off this music. I don't think we need this anymore. Okay. I don't think anyone really knows. I think everyone hits writer's block and everyone struggles through it and no one knows exactly how, but you just try different things. Sometimes if I'm hitting a block on a character and I can't get past it and I find myself drawing the same shapes and the same things and I'm just getting so frustrated because there's elements that I want to keep that was approved other times and stuff, sometimes I'll just get away from it and come at it completely different. Like draw a completely different design, think about it completely differently just to like shake my mind away from that other thing that I'm married to. Like, that's something that oftentimes helps me out. And then other times, you just have to keep the faith, kind of. Because sometimes you're just going to get... I've had many times where I get pretty depressed trying to design a character, and it's not going well. And then you just kind of... But then when you finally get something that's awesome, then, you know, it's good.
Thanks. So,
yeah, thank you. Oh, wait, here, you can have one of these drawings. Have one of these drawings. Go ahead and choose one. Oh, wait, choose one. Okay, choose one. Just in case I want to give, just choose one.
Oh, just pick one. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Whichever one you want.
I like this guy.
Okay, go
for it. I make lists too.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
Lists. Okay.
Hi, my name is Rebecca.
Hi, Rebecca. How are you?
Thank you so much for this talk. It's really inspirational.
Cool.
I had a similar question, so I came up with another. Have you ever been in a situation where you've had to draw something completely outside of your usual style? Kind of how do you find the motivation to kind of switching styles, maybe not necessarily on the fly, but having to do something that's outside of your usual scope?
Well, I mean, I think that's why in school and stuff, you're supposed to really study all types of drawing and be able to draw realistic and draw... I mean, I went to school to draw X-Men. That's what I wanted to do. And draw fantasy paintings like Frank Frazetta and stuff. So I was really into drawing realistic and really sticking to that. But after that, being exposed to different art through friends, I was able... I kind of enjoyed seeing how other people interpret stuff. So I guess it's getting the basics down and then seeing, just being really versatile, you know, being able to do it. Like after Psychonauts, that was basically like my style that I'd normally work in. And then doing Brutal Legend, like everyone had to switch to that very Frazetta style. And when you're working in a game company or a film company, you just have to be able to do it. So, and if you're not pumped on it, you got to find what makes you pumped about it. Because there's got to be something about it.
Yeah.
Something. You put a little logo in there, put your initials, I don't know.
Yeah. All right, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
My name's Byron, and the question that I have is, when you run into a specific problem, like something that your training hasn't covered, and you need a technique to get around it, where do you look to find the answers?
Say again?
So, like, let's say you run into a material that you need to render that you've never done before, so, like, a building made out of glass or something like that.
Yeah.
Where would you look to find the techniques to achieve that goal?
To achieve like a design for something I don't know much about?
Yeah.
Oh man. Well, I just go. I mean, that's always what I do before I do any drawing at all. Is just start to do tons of research and stuff. I mean, I pull a lot from Google image, you know, search, and then like sometimes those will take you to other web pages. You could find more images and you could read about it and stuff. So, I mean, sometimes I do it for a whole, like, 3 or 4 or 5 days before I start any drawing. I'll just do that for a while to kind of get a feel for it. Was that one in Cold Blood where Truman Capote spent, like, 9 months before writing a word or something like that? Like, he spent 9 months just researching and getting ready, and his publisher was always like, do you have anything to show for it? He's like, I'm still taking it in, you know? So, sometimes when you got a deadline, though, then you need to kind of speed that up.
Thank you.
No problem.
Hey, how's it going? There's some other people over here, too, just
say. Say again?
Oh, there's some other people over here.
Sorry.
You can take her first.
Oh, we'll go back and forth. Yeah, you guys. Okay, you want to go?
I can. Hi, Scott. My name is Fiona.
Hi, Fiona.
Hi. I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about the process of working with a director to create a character.
Working with a director?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, sure. I was fortunate enough to work mostly with Tim Schafer on these things, and he's just the most amazing person ever to work for on that because he cares so much about the character and the backstory and just the overall character arcs of these characters. So, and he has great taste. He has great taste in visual things as well. And I was kind of fortunate enough to work with him because we jived a lot and we were able to, you know, make each other laugh and have a good time. So I guess in that sense, but whenever I found myself like wanting to make him feel good and laugh at my drawings or get pumped or punch the air or something, and it's the sort of thing where there's certain assignments that suck, there's certain assignments that you kind of have to like go for it and And I would just go into his office and be like, oh, dude, look at this. And if he's ever, like, kind of lukewarm on it, then it's like you could use that, but you know that he's just not going to be pumped on it. So I just want to – I love the editing process. I love redrawing things, and to a point. I love redrawing things, and I love – because I wanted to make it good. You know, I want to make it – I want everyone to enjoy it, and I want to reshape things and make it really good. So, and that works well with kids' books and stuff too, because – the editing process, a lot of artists go in just from art, and they're like, dude, this is what I draw. This is what I do. You know, you don't tell me what I'm awesome at, you know? And they don't take editing process well, and that's kind of what is exciting to me. I don't know. So I love working with directors, personally.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Oh, okay.
Hey.
Yeah. Hey, what's up, man?
Super weird. So my name is Vincent. Thanks for the talk, Scott. I was just wondering, because your work's really humorous and always really funny. And I was just wondering, like, do you use that, like, the humor lens to, like, when you're designing something that's not really funny or serious? Like, is it more of a challenge for you to design something like maybe some of the stuff on Brutal Legend or even things like props that don't really have character? Like, how do you use that in your work?
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know. I guess there's always a little bit of humor in there, but there were times in Brutal Legend that I was researching some pretty terrifying stuff and drawing some pretty terrifying stuff.
Yeah.
I felt like during that time, my outside work, my paintings, got cuter and cuter the more deeper I got into this terrifying world a little bit. So it's just like finding ways to balance that stuff, you know?
Yeah.
But I think, I don't know. Tense.
Yeah.
I like scary movies. I don't like sad movies, though, I'll be honest.
That's no good.
But anyway.
Cool. Thanks.
Thanks, man. I'll wait this.
Hi.
There's one over there, too?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Oh, my gosh. Maybe you guys, if you want to go come to these two, maybe make it easier on me, but let's do this one now.
Okay.
Hey, how are you?
I'm doing good. Psychonauts is one of my favorite all-time games, and part of it is because the visuals and the story just combine wonderfully together. I feel like if you change the element of either the tone of the story or the visual graphics, it just wouldn't have meshed quite as well. So how much did you work with the narrative team on creating that game, and how did that work out?
I was art director on Psychonauts, so I was just in the... So I was working very closely with Tim, but Tim creates a really amazing environment where he kind of welcomes everyone to kind of brainstorm together. And so the designers and the game designers and the artists and himself and programmers even, everybody kind of gets involved and kind of if they have ideas to throw around and just kind of, it's like a think tank there.
So it was in tandem. It wasn't like you created the characters and then somebody else was creating the dialogue for that character. It was all kind of happening at the same time.
It usually starts with like a little snippet of information that Tim has or the game design people have, like for we need a character like this here, you know, and then I'll start doing some drawings and then Tim might start writing a story around it or he'll write a story. Some of you guys might know the story of how the camp kids were created the opposite direction because Tim and I would always go to each other and be like, dude, like you gotta write something first. And then he's like, no, just draw something and I'll write something to that. Like, there's like a little bit of like back and forth that kind of sometimes. There's kids in this camp, a whole bunch of different kids. And he was creating kind of their backstory. And what he decided for that is, like, I just drew a bunch of kids and he laid them out. And he was like, one of his deliverables, he had to come up with like a way to write all these characters out, and he was getting frustrated doing his stuff. He's procrastinating by going on Friendster back in the day. Friendster was the thing, and what he figured out was a way to use that to his advantage. And he put all the camp kids into Friendster, and then he wrote their personalities and he had them comment on each other's posts in a way that kind of let their characters rise up and become more apparent and stuff. So it really goes back and forth. I mean, that process is really a back and forth thing, and you never know when the story element will come out of drawing something and vice versa. So.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. You're welcome. Thank you. Okay.
That was totally my question, too.
Wait, that was your question? Oh, sweet. Thanks for coming up here, though. Okay.
Hey. So I was wondering if you've ever run into a situation with Tim or anyone else where you have a design that you really love, but they're just not about it for whatever reason, and if you could describe that situation and maybe how you resolved it.
No, I've had that many times. But I feel like I feel like one of my first lessons that I learned in the entertainment industry was I started working at Lucas Learning, which is like a small part of Lucas Arts, and our first game that I worked on, I was excited. It was a Star Wars game, and it was great, and I was just like, my first job, and it was only a year process for this game, and 2 weeks before it ended, they canceled it. And I was like, totally heartbroken. I was like, dude, I put so much energy into this. This is crazy, you know? And then that was just like the first lesson on how things sometimes go. You can't be married to something that much, you know? And sometimes you might love something, but then it's just not exactly right. It's not exactly right for what the situation calls for in the movie or the game or whatever. You know, it's just, you know, so even though you love it, maybe you could use that to inspire a slightly different design or use it somewhere else or something, but like, you kind of just have to roll with those punches.
Have you ever felt like it was really right and that the other person was wrong, and you just kind of swallow it?
If I'm the art director and I think it's the best, and it's someone maybe that is like if it's Tim deciding that, then yeah, Tim makes that decision. But maybe I can make a few more decisions as art director.
Yeah.
But like if I'm just designing something, you're designing something for the greater good, you guys. You can't get too married to that stuff. Because you know what? You're going to draw amazing stuff all the time. The next, you know, in an hour, you can't be married to this one thing. Like, this is my crown jewel thing. I shall never create anything as amazing. It's not going to happen, you know? Yeah. And it's like, it's kind of not a good way of thinking about that.
Thank you.
So, oh yeah, no problem. Thank you, man. Oh, I didn't catch your guys' names. What? Oh, yeah. Say your name too, so okay. I can hear it.
Hi, my name is Samantha. Samantha. I was just asking about, like, you said you use a lot of reference and you gather a lot of reference. Have you ever gotten an idea during creating a character that you go outside of your reference?
Say again, so...
Oh, well, you gather a lot of reference when you make a character. Has there ever been a point where in any of your character designs that you go outside of the reference that you gathered for, like, a good idea?
I guess gathering reference is an ongoing thing. I guess it comes from anything. I mean, you gather it from the internet, but you might be working on it and then you watch a movie and you're like, damn, that kind of inspires you. So you kind of just keep adding to the pile of stuff all the time. It's not like it's a set time, like, this day is my reference day. After this day, no more reference. It's like you just keep adding to it, you know, keep adding to it and have more stuff, whatever works for you and stuff, you know.
Okay.
So.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. Hi.
Hey.
I'm Adam. Great talk. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks.
I was just going to ask you about your process. When you're designing characters in the initial phase, do you find that when you're drawing, you find one character or design that you really, really like and you instantly know? Or is it a process that requires a lot of deliberation to land on the right one?
Most times, yeah. I rarely am just like, this is the one. And if I do, it's just like, you know, I'm not married to it, as we've discussed.
That's my experience as well. Thank you.
Oh, cool, man. Good. All right. We're at time?
Yeah.
Right now?
I'm afraid we're starting to go over, but if you want to ask some more questions.
You guys, sorry about that, and thank you.